We're gonna look at some things in Deuteronomy this morning. Come up with this lesson. It's probably would be better fit for younger people, but we're gonna do it anyway. Y'all not gonna hear anything you hadn't heard, probably know more about than I do, so let's turn to Deuteronomy chapter 6. We'll read a few verses and then we'll make some comments. If y'all got anything to add during this lesson, well, be sure to speak up. That's why we're here, you know, to learn more about God's Word. So if y'all got anything to enlighten us, well, be sure to speak up. Deuteronomy chapter 6, verse 1. Now these are the commandments, the statutes, and the judgments which the Lord your God commanded to teach you, that you might do them in the land where you go to possess it, that thou mightest fear the Lord thy God, to keep all his statutes and his commandments, which I command thee, thou and thy son, thy son's son, all the days of thy life, and that thy days may be prolonged. Hear therefore, O Israel, and observe to do it, that it may be well with thee, that you may increase mightily, as the Lord God of thy fathers hath promised thee in the land that floweth with milk and honey. Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God is one Lord. Thou shalt love the Lord thy God with all thy heart, with all thy soul, with all thy might. And these words which I command thee this day shall be in thy heart. Thou shalt teach them diligently unto thy children, and shalt talk with them when thou sittest in thine house, when thou walkest by the way, when thou liest down, when thou risest up. Thou shalt bind them for a sign upon thine hand. They shall be as frontlets between thine eyes. Thou shalt write them upon the posts of thy house and on thy gates. We'll stop right there. The verse we're going to focus on this morning, key verse in this study, is going to be verse 5. Where it says, and thou shalt love the Lord thy God with all thy heart, with all thy soul, with all thy might. Here in verse 1, Moses is the one that's given his command here, or was given the command to teach the children of Israel that they might do them in the land where they go to possess it. So we're looking at love and obeying God today. This is something that can be kind of humbling to us as believers, because we can't love the way God loved us. I don't think we're capable of loving the way God loves us, but we can do the best we can by showing our love toward Him, by serving Him, and be obedient to His commands. But we can never love as God loved us. Jeremiah chapter 31, verse 3 says, the Lord's love is everlasting. His love is everlasting. Our love is inconsistent, probably to say the least, and everlasting. We're kind of up and down, hot and cold. I guess you might ask the question here, well, how in the world does one measure love, you know? How do you measure love? God's love is everlasting, and our love can't be like His. So our love is inconsistent, but we're to be obedient to his commands. It's one way that we can show our love. Matthew chapter 22, verse 36 through 38. I'm going to turn there and read that. Matthew 22, 36. I'll get there in a minute. Okay, in verse 36, it says, Master, which is a Pharisee, asking this question. In verse 35, so then one of them, which was a lawyer, asked him a question, tempting him, and said, Master, which is a great commandment in the law? Jesus said to him, Thou shalt love the Lord thy God with all thy heart, with all thy soul, with all thy mind. This is the first and great commandment. So we're commanding here to love the God, or Lord God, with all our heart, with all our soul, with all our mind, for everything we have. loving the Lord. It says there, and this is the first and great commandment. We as believers are to show our love for God the same way that the Old Testament believers were to show a life of obedience. In other words, obeying His commandments is the way we can show our love toward the Lord. And 1 Samuel chapter 15, verse 22 says, to obey is better than sacrifice. So God wants us to follow His commandments, be obedient to His commands, show His love by a life of obedience. In 2 John 6, John says, he writes that we walk after God's commandments. This is showing our love. This is love. They walk after His commandments. 2 John verse 6. A Christian must not allow love to erode away or erode by becoming closely attached to the world. You know, if we get too close to the world, get to being like the world, then our love is going to erode. It's going to just drift away, wear away gradually. We get away from God. So we're told in 1 John chapter 2, verse 15, love not the world. And we're in the world. We have to live in the world. We don't have to love the things that's going on in the world. Be like worldly people. We don't have to be that way. 1 John chapter 2, verse 15 says, love not the world, neither the things that are in the world. If any man love the world, the love of the Father is not in him. For all that is in the world, the lust of the flesh, the lust of the eyes, the pride of life is not the Father, not of the Father, but is of the world. We're admonished here to separate ourselves from worldly things. We're not to be like the people of the world, though they're not saved. We're to live our life serving the Lord and obeying His commands and not serving the devil as the world is. Excuse me. The way things are in this time, you know, our love for God should grow deeper in the midst of this world's troubles, difficult times. You know, you look at our government, our leaders, what's going on up there in Washington, it's terrible. And all the hate in the world, the chaos, just as you watch the news, you see that stuff so much, it's just like everybody's out of control. It's difficult, I guess, to focus on the Lord when you see so much of this stuff, especially if you watch the TV, watch the news. It's just so much of that hate, chaos. People just, I don't know, it's like they want something to fuss about, to rise up and protest and do all this stuff. And our government leaders, it's a shame that we can't have honest people up there leading our nation instead of some of the people we got up there that just, we're crooked. A lot of them just plain crooked. That's about all you can say for it. But anyway, we shouldn't let that discourage us. We should let our love for the Lord grow deeper even in these difficult times. And they are difficult. You know, Paul didn't let these trials and tribulations hinder the progress of the gospel or in his perfect walk with God. And we shouldn't either. You know, we shouldn't let these things hinder us in our walk with the Lord. We have to be on guard and not be led or pulled away from God. it's a spiritual battle living in this world today with all the things that's going on. And that Satan has to pull us away from God. And we are sealed. You know, we can't blame everything on somebody else. Some things we do, we have to make better decisions if we don't get caught in some of that kind of stuff. But anyway, we're told here in these scriptures, we're to separate ourselves from the world. Again, we have to live here, but we don't have to be like the world. And we got friends. We all, I know, got friends that are not saved, which we have to be friendly to people, you know, to get close to them if we want to tell them about the Lord. We have befriend them, but we don't have to be like the world. Love can be known only from actions it prompts. I guess it's a good way to define love. Love, the word love, is often used loosely today. It's abused and used, I don't know, it's so loose today. I love this, I love that, I love this and that, that. That's not really the love that we're talking about. That when people make those kind of statements, it should be like, I like your house, I like the way you look, I like the car you got and stuff. It's not, people use love for that all the time instead of liking it. Love is a lot deeper than that. It's really used loosely today. 1 John chapter 4 and verse 8. God says, "Or he that loveth not, knoweth not God, for God is love." You know, again, we can't love, it's God. God loves, but we're commanded to love, you know, love one another, love God. God's love is seen in his creation. All, look at all the things around us, so beautiful. God has made, he showed us his love through his creation, through his sustenance, through his protection of his people, and offers a redemption for people that we were so unworthy. He gave his only begotten son because he loved us enough to give his only begotten son that we could have life everlasting. We don't deserve any of that. If we got what we deserve, we'd all go to everlasting hell because we don't deserve God's love. His love is unconditional. We don't have to be good for God to love us, you know, because he gave his only begotten son to save the world, save lost sinners. That's love. I was going to quote this, John chapter 3 verse 16. I know all y'all can quote this. I thought I could, but I think I probably might mess it up. But anyway, it says, "For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son." He so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. Well, that's love. God gave his only son for a bunch of undeserving people. Now, his love, again, is unconditional. Matthew chapter 5, verse 45, it says there, "As the sun rises on the evil and the good, it rains on the just and the unjust." So God's love is unconditional. He treats everybody the same. He loves everybody. The word "whosoever" there in John 3:16 makes it very clear on the unconditional nature of God making redemption possible for all. It's unconditional. That's his nature. Making redemption possible for all. And that's not just those that live an upstanding, good life. You know, it makes no difference who or what people are. Don't make any difference what they've done or who they are. God made redemption possible for all. And again, or whether or not a person actually receives this redemption is conditional on his or her part, or is accessing or receiving it only through Jesus. Whether or not a person actually receives redemption is conditional on his or her accessing or receiving it only through Jesus, as we're told in John chapter 14, verse 6. God's love is often unreturned. There's so many people that simply reject God. His love is not returned. And this is sad. It's going to be a sad day when these people stand at the great white throne judgment when God turns them away because they rejected him. They're not going to have a second chance. That's going to be a sad day. So many people think they're living right, everything's going okay, it's going to be all right in the end. Not so. If they don't know the Lord as their Savior, it's going to be a sad day because they just rejected him. God loves us, for he gave his only begotten Son. The Bible teaches, as we said now, that we should love God in return. I'm going to turn to 1 John chapter 4. I'll read a couple of verses there. Are you going to get back to teaching in that book, Kenneth?
I don't know.
First John chapter 4, verse 19 says, we love him because he first loved us. And verse 10 said, herein is love, not that we love God, but that he loved us and sent his Son to be the propitiation for our sin. And verse 9, I should read that before verse 10, it says, this was manifested love of God toward us, because God sent his only begotten Son to the world that we might live through him. Herein is love, not that we love God, but that he loved us and sent his Son to be the propitiation for our sins. So, I think there's a lot of saved people that don't show their love toward God. If they did, this building would be full of people. People say they love God, but they don't want to get up and come to church. They don't want to do anything for him. They don't want to serve him. To me, they're not showing their love to God for being disobedient. Love should show itself, not just emotional, but it should be real. In other words, our love real for God. People love real for God. Yeah, I believe if one is really loves God, he's going to show it by his praise and worship and obedience to his command and service. That's the only way we can show our love toward God in these things. Praise and worship and obedience, service. John 14:15 again, if you love me, keep my commandments. And Deuteronomy 10:12 says, now Israel, what does the Lord thy God require of thee? But to fear the Lord thy God, to walk in all his ways, and to love him, and to serve the Lord thy God with all thy heart, with all thy soul. That's what God required of Israel, and he required the same thing of us. What does thy Lord thy God require of thee, but to fear the Lord, walk in his ways, love him, and serve the Lord God with all thy heart and all thy soul. Anybody got any comments, anything you want to add? Speak up. To keep the commandments of the Lord and his statute, which I command thee this day for thy good. Amen. Anyway, in this passage of scripture here where we read chapter 6 of Deuteronomy, Moses is addressing these people here, which are the second generation of Israelites, which following the Exodus from Egypt. The first generation perished in the wilderness because of unbelief that God couldn't lead them to conquer the inhabitants of the land was their destination. And you can read a lot of this, or about this, in Numbers chapter 14. I'm not going to turn there and read that, but that whole chapter is about this, and where they provoked God to anger, they wanted to go back to Egypt. The whole chapter is about their unbelief that God could lead them to conquer this land that they were promised. Anyway, this first generation having passed from the scene, the second generation is on the verge of entering this promised land of Canaan, and they needed the law of Moses explained again because they weren't there whenever this covenant was made with Israel, with God. He established his covenant with the first generation of Israelites, and they died in the wilderness. They weren't there, so the second generation was needing this, and they were given the Ten Commandments again in chapter 5 there. So the first time it was in Exodus chapter 21, the second time it was the second generation in chapter 5 of Deuteronomy, if y'all want to read that sometime. Anyway, he reminded the people of God's faithfulness and the power he had previously shown in having some of the people conquered the land. They were east of Jordan. This was in chapter 2, verse 24 through chapter 3, verse 11. And again, I'm not going to go there and read that. I'll read that sometime if you like. But anyway, God had the same power, and it was to guide these, the second generation, in completing this conquest of the territory to the west side of Jordan. So anyway, those of the second generation were required to avoid the unfaithfulness of their predecessors. They died in the wilderness because of their unbelief and disobedience to God's command. In chapter 5, verse Deuteronomy, it ends with the exhortation to the people to obey the Lord faithfully and not to turn aside to the right hand or to the left. In verse 32 there of chapter 5, it says, "You shall observe to do therefore as the Lord your God has commanded you. You shall not turn aside to the right hand or to the left." In other words, to be steadfast. And this is a good a point for us today, or applies today. And we're not to turn from side to side. We're to look straight ahead, look at God, follow his commandments. And it continues in this chapter 6, where Moses is teaching this second generation here. Verse 1, it shows responsibility given to Moses to teach the Israelites. He was commanded by God to teach them the commandments, the statutes, the judgment, that they might do them in the land that they were to possess. The other responsibility is placed on the people themselves. They must actually do what God has said in faithfulness to his words. This is a parallel, or the duties, two duties that are found in the Great Commission, or responsibilities, when Jesus commanded his followers. He said, make disciples, teach those disciples to do, to observe all things whatsoever I have commanded you. As we read in verse 28 through 19 and 20 in Matthew, and then verse 2, that they might fear the Lord their God. Says here, that thou mightest fear the Lord God to keep all his statutes, all his commandments, which I command thee. Thou and thy son, and thy son's son, all the days of thy life, that thy days may be prolonged. Yeah, coming down to hit myself here. But anyway, he's teaching that these people might fear the Lord the God. Have a reverence, have a deep reverence for God, who he is. The fear here is not like just trembling because God's going to strike you dead, but it's a fear, like a wholesome dread of displeasing him, afraid that you're not going to please him. And that's the kind of fear that we should have today. You know, if we don't do what God commands, follow his will, and we might have a fear that God's not going to bless us like he otherwise would, and that's right, he won't. Anyway, he's the God of the Bible. He's holy, he's loving, he's righteous, he's faithful, and all along to name just a few of his attributes. The fear of the Lord, fear of God, acknowledges that we must come to him in his terms, not ours. We can't come to him in their way. We have to come to his way. That's the only way. The second part of that verse there says, "Thou, my son's son, all the days of thy life, that thy days may be prolonged." This commandment was given to the second generation here of Israel. It wasn't given to the Israelites alone. The second generation was teaching there to all that follow, future generations, don't just I'll take it and hide it in your heart. Saying that he's teaching here that they should teach the following generation of people so it can be carried on. Every generation following would have a need to see itself as having a responsibility to teach the faith to those that follow. And this is, I think, something that many of God's people are failing in today, is teaching their children to follow the Lord. There's so many things. I guess just calling people away. It's so busy, they ain't got time to teach or something. I don't know, but you can see it in the churches today. You know, these older folks, people that were here before us, were teaching their children teaching their children. Well, it just seems like it's getting further and further away from God with things going on in churches today. And, maybe a lot of these kids are not being taught like they should be. Anyway, that's what this is all about here. Commands that Moses has given these people here. They have the responsibility of teaching faith to those that follow. We have the same thing. All of our kids are grown now, we've got grandkids, but it's sad to say I've got 7 grandkids, and Linda, and there's none of them serving the Lord like they should. They go to church some, but they're not serving the Lord like they should. We've failed somewhere or something. It's just the world is pulling away, but you can see that. That's what's happening in the churches. This younger generation may not seem, or may think it's not relevant, you know, these teachings today, but it is. Verse 3, he says, "Hear therefore, Israel, and observe to do it, that it may be well with thee, and that you may increase mightily as the Lord of thy fathers hath promised thee, in the land of flow of milk and honey. Hear therefore, O Israel, and observe to do it." Verse 3 there says, "He may increase mightily as the Lord God thy fathers have promised thee in the land of milk and honey." Speaking of the abundance, things that awaited Israel in the promised land of Canaan, in contrast to what they had, what it was called in Deuteronomy 4:20, the iron furnace of Egypt. You know, they were in bondage there in Egypt, and this is speaking of the abundance they have awaiting in the land of Canaan. Verse 4, "Hear, O Israel, the Lord God is one. He alone is God, there's no other." You know, back in the Old Testament days, the pagan religion had many gods. You know, they had a god for this, a god for that, just many different gods, but there's only one God. One God, one Lord. He alone is God, there is no other. Verse 5, this is the main theme of our lesson today. "Thou shalt love Lord thy God, with all thy heart, with all thy soul, with all thy mind." In other words, we're to put everything we have into loving the Lord, serving Him. The heart speaks of the hidden man, the real man, a source of emotion, especially love or affection and devotion. The soul, the inner man, the invisible part of man, the spiritual part of man, which is distinct from the physical part of man, and might, great power, ability, or strength, with all one strength. This is what we're to, the way we're to serve the Lord. "Love the Lord God with all my heart, all my soul, with all my mind." Be good if we could do that. We're to put all that we have in our total being into loving God and following His commandments. And verse 6, "That these words which I command thee this day shall be in thy heart." Keep these words treasured in your heart. Psalms chapter 119, verse 11, well, actually, verse 1 through 11, says there, and thy word have I hid in my heart, and I might not sin against thee. But those are good verses there. I'm going to turn there and read. It's about time for me to quit. So, anyway, verse 7 says, thou shalt teach them diligently to thy children. Verse 7, thou shalt teach them diligently to thy children, shalt talk to them when thou sittest in thine house, when thou walkest by the way, when thou liest down, when thou risest up. God's word is not to be hoarded in our heart. We're to hide it in our heart, as the scripture says, but we're not to hoard it in our heart. We're to share it. It's to be passed on or communicated to others, especially the children in the household. There's a lot of grandparents that are raising their grandchildren today. This would apply as well. And sometimes I think the grandparents may do a better job of passing it on than the parents. But anyway, it's a command from God to just be done. I want to stop right there. I may finish a little more to say on this next week. And we'll go from there. Anyway, this command to love the Lord. Love Him with all our heart, all our mind, all our soul, and follow His command. Obey Him. He will bless our lives. All right. Thank y'all for coming this morning and sitting here. Well, let's be as we go to prayer. Father, thank you again for the day you've given us to come to your house. We thank you for these that come here, Father, to worship you and honor you in your service this day. We pray that you'll bless each one that came today, Father, will be here in the following service, Father. Bless them for putting away the cured of life, Father. Setting them aside and come here to worship you. We pray your blessing on Brother. Brother George, Father, bless him as he comes before us this morning, Father, preaching your word again for one of them is today that doesn't know the Lord is our Savior. It be the day that they accept him before it's turning too late. Again, bless each one that came, Father. Give us a good day. Bless the service this afternoon. Lead, guide, and direct us. Forgive us where we fail. Ask in Jesus' holy name. Amen. Thank y'all.